friends, let me introduce. I am Dr. Prithvi Singh from Department of Physics. This year we offer subject Physics First for the semester first. Subject code is PH151, and the whole syllabus are divided into the four parts. The first one is the vector and electrostatics. Second is magnetostatics and time varying field. Third one is the optics, and the last part is the elementary quantum mechanics. The books for the whole syllabus we will be consider M.N.O. Sazuki for elements of the electromagnetics, Ajay Ghatak for the optics. So today I will start the optics. We already discussed about the vectors and magnetostatics and time varying field. So let me start the optics. So very basic principle of a optic is light. So what is the light? The question is, what do you mean by the light? So when we talk about the light, so the first answer is that light is an electromagnetic. So what exactly is the electromagnetic? So let's try consider, suppose a wave is propagating in z direction. This is x, this is y and z. So if any wave is propagating along the z axis, I can represent the wave by the following diagram. Now here I have the two loops. One I denoted by the shadow line and another by the blank. So this represents my electric field vector, while this is my magnetic component. So every time electric and magnetic fields are perpendicular to each other, that means E and B are mutually perpendicular to each other. So in a light we can say it's a combination of electric or magnetic components. So I can say it consists of the vibration of the electric field and the magnetic field. It's vibrate in XY plane. The electric field and magnetic field are perpendicular to each other. As I explained that both are the mutually perpendicular to each other, and electromagnetic wave is the transfer in nature. And we can say the speed of the light is 3 × 10⁸ meter per second. This is the speed of the light. So all these are the characteristics of a light. So now based on the light we will be discuss the different phenomena of the light. So phenomena are interference, diffraction and polarization. Now interference and diffraction explain the wave nature. That means we can give information of a light about the wave by using these two phenomena, interference and diffraction. But when we talk about the characteristics of the light, then we use the phenomena of the polarization. So basically the polarization is this one. I can explain in this manner that if electric field, either electric or magnetic field, are restricted to vibrate in a particular plane, that means in a single plane, then I can say my light is a polarized light. That means my plane is a fixed. So this is my diagram of an ordinary light and polarized light. So this represents the ordinary light. In ordinary light we can see that the vibrations of electric and magnetic fields are in all directions, every direction, everywhere, right? So we can say it's a superpositions of a different wave. Suppose I have the one wave, another wave. So there may be the possibility of a superposition. So in unpolarization light, there is a superposition of the different waves. But in case of the polarization, our wave is restricted in a particular plane. So let this is our plane. So in this plane, all the electromagnetic waves are lying in the same plane. So we have a fixed plane. This is the characteristics of a polarization polarized light. Now we have a different type of a polarized light. So very first, when we talk about a plane polarized light, the first one is the plane polarized light. So the first I am writing plane polarized light. So in a plane polarized light, if I draw the polarized light, then the light will be free to vibrate in a single plane. This one, light is free to vibrate in a single plane. This is my xy plane. So all the oscillations will be occur in a xy plane. So this is known as the plane polarized light. One is the linearly polarized light. Another one is the linearly polarized light. Linearly polarized light. So what happens in a linearly polarized light? Either light will be oscillate in a perpendicular to the plane or parallel in a direction of a moving. So let's, this is X, Y, and Z. So oscillations may be upward, downward to the surface, or I represent this perpendicular oscillations by dot. Okay? Or parallel. Parallel means all are in this direction. All the oscillations will be occur in this direction. Then I can say this polarized light is known as the linearly polarized light. Okay, one more polarized light is partially polarized light. So what is the partially polarized light? The partially polarized light means some of the components of light follow the characteristics of the polarization while some of are unpolarized. So I can represent the partially polarized light by this diagram. Now look at some of the components are the polarized. All these are the polarized because the magnitudes of this line are the same. But some of the lines are small, so we can say it's a partially polarized light. One more polarized light is elliptically polarized light. Elliptically polarized light. Polarized light. So when we talk about the ellipse, so means ellipse means if we have two components like R1 and R2, so in ellipse these two radius are different. One is R1 and another is R2. In my light I have the two components, one is E1 and another is E2. So in elliptically polarized light, these two components are different. E2 is not equal to E2, but the phase angle between these two electrical components is 90. This is 90. Then I can say our elliptically polarized light. So now I represent the elliptically polarized light by using this expression. So this is X, this is Y, and this is Z. So two components are different, but the phase angle is 90. So let's I draw one of the part which magnitude is E1 and another larger than of the first one. Again, small, larger. Right, and another component is perpendicular to this one. So right, so the angle between this one and this is my E1 electrical component, this is the E2, and the angle between this E1 and E2 is 90, and the magnitude is the different. E1 is not equal to E2, then it represents the elliptically polarized light. Now we take a circularly polarized light. So what happens in circular equilibrium that when we talk about the circular circle, the radius, everywhere the radius is the common, same. So in this case, E1 will be, in circular polarized light, E1 will be equal to E2, and again the phase angle is 90 degree. So everywhere this loop has the same magnitude, this loop has the same magnitude. So this is the example of a circularly polarized light. Again, it's represented graphical representation of an polarized light. So already I explained all our lines in a different plane wise polarized light is represented in a particular plane. This dot represents perpendicular to the plane, while this arrow represents in a parallel form. Okay, so this is a three-dimensional picture of a polarized light. How we can obtain a polarized light by unpolarized light? So let this is a mixture of a different polarized light. That means this is an unpolarized light. So when this unpolarized light falls on a polarizer is one material which converts a unpolarized light into a polarized light. So when unpolarized light different amplitude is fall on a polarizer, finally outcome will be the polarized light. Here we can see everywhere all the light lie in the same plane or at the same magnitude. So unpolarized light converted into a polarized light by using this polarizer. Right, so now the question is how we can produce a linearly polarized light. How we can produce a linearly polarized light? So there are the different methods for the production of a polarized light, and these methods are, one is the reflection, second one is the refraction, third is the scattering, and the last one is the double reflection. So all these different light phenomena we can produce a polarized light. So first we consider a reflection. So let's reflection. So reflection means we will be find out the polarized light by reflection technique. So suppose we have a glass layer. This is our glass layer and it's represented normal n prime. Normal means I'm writing here n prime is normal. Normal means polarized light will be lying in this plane. So this is the normal. I represent the unpolarized light. This is our unpolarized light. Polarized light. So this unpolarized light is incident on this glass surface. Let the refractive index is mu 1 outer one, and the glass material refractive index is mu 2. So this unpolarized light is incident at an incident angle I, or we can say theta, and at point let's say A point B, some of the light ray will be transmitted through this glass material, and some of the light will be reflected back into the same medium. That means the incident light will be come out in the same medium. This is our reflected part, this is our transmitted part. Now both reflected and the transmitted part have both the components, that means perpendicular as well as a parallel component. So perpendicular we represent by dot and parallel component by the arrow. Right. Now the reflected part have some component of parallel, while most of the components are perpendicular. So now we can say both are the partially polarized light. Reflected light as well as the transmitted are the partially polarized light. Identify a polarized light is incident on a simple glass plate. Some of this portion are transmitted and others are reflected. But after that, both have the partially polarized light. So if we change this angle is important. So if we change this angle theta, so at a particular angle, which I denoted by symbol theta p, unpolarized light is theta p, polarized angle. At a polarized angle, all of my reflected part have only perpendicular components. All are the perpendicular component, while transmitted as both the component perpendicular as well as a parallel component. I represent the perpendicular component by S component. By parallel component is represented by P component. So S is perpendicular, P is for parallel. So at a particular angle theta P, which is known as the polarized angle, this reflected part have S component. That means this light is completely linearly polarized light. This is completely linearly polarized light. So by using ordinary light, by the technique of reflection, we convert a unpolarized light into a linearly polarized light. The technique is very simple by using just this reflector technique. But what is the drawback of this technique? The drawback of this technique is that the intensity of this reflected part is around 15% of the intensity of the incident light. So this is the one of the drawback of this technique. Right. So the next is the reflection technique. By using the reflection technique, we will produce a plane polarized light. Next is refraction technique. Now what happens here, we see that it's a partially polarized light. Reflected light is the completely polarized light, while the transmitted light is the partially polarized light. So how we can convert this partially polarized light into a polarized light, because this is the refracted part. So what we are considering? We are considering a number of the glass plates, that is the slab of the glass plate. There are just different glass plates. And now this unpolarized light is incident on this bunch of glass plates. So in that case, the S component, this reflected component will be split. This S component will be filtered. So the remaining component outcome will be, the polarized light, which is refracted part. So in this technique, by using a reflected light, we find out the polarized light. So that's why you say this is the technique of finding the polarized light by using a reflection phenomenon. Right. Okay, before we start the scheduling technique, I would like to explain the Brewster law. The Brewster law is very important law for finding the polarizing angle. So, Brewster law, basically, what exactly is the Brewster law? We see that theta b is the polarizing angle. So, if theta b is the polarizing angle, then we can find out the refractive index of a material by using the theta b, and the refractive index will be mu equals to tan theta p. This is known as the Brewster law. I will derive this part. So that means the polarizing angle is useful for determinations of a refractive index of a material. So I consider again a glass slab, my normal N prime, the light is incident at an angle of theta p. This is a reflected part, reflected linearly polarized light. So again, this is a theta p and this is a reflecting angle r. So theta p and r is a reflecting angle. So by using the geometry, we know the relation theta p plus r is equal to 90 degrees. So this angle is 90. Theta p plus r is 90. Right? So using the Snell law. What is the Snell law? So if its a refractive index is mu 1, another the medium refractive index is mu 2. So Snell law says that sin i upon sin r is equal to mu 2 upon mu 1. I is the incident angle, r is reflected angle. Again, mu 2 is the refractive index of the material and mu 1 is the refractive index of a outermost part. So in our case, I is the theta b and r is 90 minus theta b, because we have the relation theta p plus r is equal to 90 degrees. So now I substitute the value of I and r in this expression. So sin I is equal to theta b upon sin r is 90 minus theta b. 90 minus theta b. Right? 90 minus theta b is equal to mu 2 upon mu 1. Now I call it sin theta b, and this is sin 90 minus theta is cos. Cos theta b is equal to mu 2 upon mu 1. Right? So I can write here. So this is tan theta b, sin by cos is equal to tan theta b, sin by cos is equal to tan theta b is equal to mu 2 upon mu 1. Or theta b I can write is tan inverse mu 2 upon mu 1. This is known as the Brewster law. And this theta b is known as the Brewster angle. Now, why we derive this expression? Why we need the Brewster law? Because there are the applications of the Brewster law, and the application is it is used to determine the refractive index of opaque materials. If you want to find out the refractive index of the opaque material, we can find out the refractive index by using the Brewster law. It is for calculating the polarizing angle necessary for the total polarization of the reflected light. We can find out this theta b. It is utilized Brewster angle for transmitting a light beam into or out of an optical fiber without reflection losses. So all these three are the application of a Brewster law. One more law based on reflection in the Mel's law. Mel's law. Mel's law. So the Mel's law is basically predict that intensity of the polarized light transmitted through the analyzer is proportional to cosine square of the angle between the plane of transmission of analyzer and the plane of transmission of polarizer. I explain it. I have one polarizer and one more is the analyzer. Both have the same property. Polarizer and analyzer both are made by a same material. So polarizer converts unpolarized light into a polarized light. Analyzer is used to analyze this polarized light. So this is unpolarized light, and this unpolarized light incident on polarizer. This is the polarizer. So when this unpolarized light incident on a polarizer, finally it converts unpolarized light into the polarized light. This is the parallel component, linearly polarized light, polarized light. Now I use a analyzer here. This is analyzer, right? So if the angle between this polarizer and analyzer, angle between this polarizer analyzer is zero, then outcome will be the completely polarized light. If there is some angle, like I rotate this analyzer, with angle theta, then the intensity of the outcome of this polarized light will be the different from the incident light. So relation will be derived by matter that intensity of outcome will be I naught cos square theta. Now theta is the angle between this polarizer and analyzer. This angle theta, I naught is the intensity of an incident polarized light. So this is our outcome will be defined by this expression. This is known as the Mel's law. This is our Mel's law. Okay, so we cover reflections, refractions. The next one is the scattering technique for finding the polarized light. What happens in a scattering technique? Suppose we have a transmitted layer and a unpolarized light is incident on this transmitted layer. This unpolarized light is incident on this transmitted layer. Then this light will be scattered by the atoms of this transmitted layer, and it will be move in this direction, scatter, and this scatter light will be partially polarized light. Partially polarized, it means dot, arrow, dot, and so on. So unpolarized light converted into a partially polarized light if the angle between the scatter light and the incident is 90, or we can say if the scatter light is at an angle of 90, this will be perfectly polarized light. That means at the angle of 90, this scatter light will be completely converted into a polarized light. At theta is equal to 90, scatter light will convert into polarized light. So this is the technique which is known as the scattering technique for finding the polarized light. The last one is the double diffraction. Okay, so in double refractions, as we write the name, double refractions means we have the two refracted light. So basically what happens, when the light, ordinary light, incident on a calcite crystal. Calcite crystal means calcium carbonate crystal. Is incident on a calcite crystal, it will be converted into the two part. That means it produces the two refracted light. So let's, I have one calcite crystal. When unpolarized light incident on a calcite crystal, it produces the two light, two refracted light. One is E ray, this is called O ray, and this is known as the E ray. O ray means ordinary ray. E ray means extraordinary ray. Now the difference between ordinary and extraordinary ray is that ordinary ray follows the Snell law. This means it follows the Snell law. While extraordinary light do not follow the Snell law. So if we rotate this calcite crystal, this ordinary ray light is rotating around this E ray. That means E ray is the fixed, while the O ray is rotating around this E ray. This technique of find out the polarized light by the double refraction, by the refraction, is known as the double diffraction. In this case, ordinary light converted into the two double diffracted ray. So we have the four methods for find out the polarized light. One is reflection technique, another is the refraction technique, third one is the scattering, and the last one is the double diffraction technique. So in next class, we will be find out the different plates, quarter wave plates, half wave plates, for find out the different polarized light. So here I stop it. Thank you.